Did we exist before pre-life? Did we exist before we were born? No? Yes? Where did we exist?
Written in the book.
But that's not an actual existence. This is an existence in Allah's knowledge. Written in the book? Yes, we are written in the book. Did we exist as separate individuals? No? Yes? Both of you are right. Yes and no. How is that possible? It depends on what you mean. There was an existence. We call it in English primordial existence, the existence before existence. And this is referenced in the Quran, in Surah Al-A'raf. وَإِذْ أَخَذَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَنِي آدَمَ مِنْ ظُهُورِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ وَأَشْهَدَهُمْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ قَالُوا بَلَىٰ شَهِدْنَا. This is a very profound verse in the Quran. And the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they explain and clarify it. And it goes as follows. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we all know, He sent our father Adam down to this world. We all know that. And our mother Hawa, they came down. And Allah Azza wa Jal accepted the repentance of Adam in this dunya. وَعَصَى آدَمُ رَبَّهُ فَغَوَى ثُمَّ اجْتَبَاهُ رَبُّهُ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ وَهَدَى. Adam disobeyed. Then Allah Azza wa Jal accepted his tawbah. Where did Allah accept his tawbah? According to the reports, in the valley of An-Nu'man, in Arafat. In Arafat. And when Allah Azza wa Jal accepted his tawbah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala extracted right then and there. This is an interesting point. Very few people know this, but it's in the books of hadith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala extracted from Adam alayhi salam every single ruh of every human being that is going to be born from his time up until Qiyamah. Allah created Adam up there, not down here. And Allah created his body up there. And Allah blew the ruh of Adam up there. وَنَفَخَ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِهِ. So the ruh of Adam, Allah created directly himself. And Allah shaped Adam himself. And Allah blew the ruh into Adam himself. So that is Adam alayhi salam. Where was my ruh created? Where was your ruh created? In this world. When? When Allah accepted the repentance of Adam. From the ruh of Adam, min aslabi Adam, as the hadith goes, from the loins of Adam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala khalaqa all of the dhurriya of Adam. This is when the khalq happens. So, our ruh, not our bodies, our ruh was created at that point in time in Arafat. And Allah Azza wa Jal put all of these arwah in front of him. فَنَثَرَهُمْ بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ. All of these arwah are in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah spoke to these arwah. So this means the arwah, the ruh, they had intellect, they could think. They're not body, they're just ruh. And Allah asked them, in the Quran it says, what did He ask them? أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ. This is in the Quran, Surah Al-A'raf 172 or 178, look it up. Am I not your Lord? قَالُوا. We all said, بَلَى. Yes, you are our Lord. So this means we did exist before our existence in this world. And we existed in a way that we don't have memory of it. I don't remember the day of أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ. Do you remember it? Anybody remember it? No. But we answered Allah. We answered, oh Allah, we know you are true. We know you are worthy of worship. We know you exist. And that answering, by the way, this is what we call the fitrah that's inside of us. It's something that's embedded inside. We know Allah exists. Every human being, Muslim and kafir, Buddhist and Hindu, male and female, everybody, deep down inside, there's something called the fitrah. And that fitrah goes back to the day of Alastu. Alastu bi Rabbikum. So all of mankind said, yes, O Allah, we know you are our Lord. There's something inside that knows right from wrong. Now, then what happened? Then, in the wombs of our mothers, on the 40th day of conception, the hadith in Bukhari says, the angel comes and breathes the ruh into the fetus. So, who breathes my ruh and your ruh into us? The angel. Unlike Adam, who breathed Adam? Allah Azza wa Jalla. Big difference. On the 40th day, the angel comes and breathes the ruh into every lady who is pregnant. And our mothers, your mother, all of us, that's where the ruh comes. And then we are born into this world. Now in this life, our ruh and our body are always connected. There's only one time where the connection becomes partial and not full, and that is during time of sleep. What is sleep? Sleep is when the ruh partially leaves the body, not fully. And that is why when we go to sleep, our ruh remains connected via some mechanism we do not know. The scholars say some type of invisible thread, but in the end of the day, it's ilm al-ghayb. But the point is that sleeping is a type of death. And this is in the Quran and in the Sunnah. Allahu yatawaffa al-anfusa hina mawtiha wallati lam tamut fi manamiha. Allah takes the souls when they die and when they go to sleep. This is in the Quran. In their nawm and in their maut, Allah takes the souls. But what is the difference? When Allah takes the soul at the time of sleeping, the soul is connected. When Allah takes the soul at the time of death, cut off. Nothing. Complete infisal, complete disconnection between the soul and the body. And that is why it is so common that people die in their sleep, because it's a stepping stone. They go to sleep and they never wake up. And that's common. One of the common types of death is people go to sleep and they don't wake up. Why? Because essentially the soul was taken at sleep and then never sent back. And that is why in Jannah there will be no sleeping. Because our Prophet ﷺ said, hadith is authentic, simple hadith. An-nawmu akhu al-mawt. It's a hadith. Sleeping is the brother of death. So, because there's going to be no death in the Akhirah, there will be no sleep in the Akhirah. You will say, but hold on a sec, I'm going to get tired. And the response is, in Jannah, there is never getting tired. There is never feeling sleepy. There is never a sense of fatigue. That's why Jannah is Jannah. Inna ashab al-jannah al-yawma fi shughulin faqibun. Verily, the people of Jannah will be perpetually busy in having fun. The point being that in this dunya, we will never face, obviously, a permanent separation of the ruh from the body until the actual time of death comes. And of course, we all know that the time of death is something that no one knows except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And فَإِذَا جَاءَ أَجَلُهُمْ فَلَا يَسْتَأْخِرُونَ سَاعَةً وَلَا يَسْتَقْدِمُونَ. When the time of death comes, they can neither delay it by a second, nor can they precede it by a second. And death will come, as Allah says in the Quran, even if they are in protected fortress. And every one of us, listen to this, has an angel assigned just to take our soul. It is a common misconception that there is one Malakul Maut. No, no. There is one head Malakul Maut, yes. But every one of us has an angel whose only purpose, the only job that he has, is you are the Malakul Maut for so-and-so. You are the Malakul Maut for so-and-so. Because Allah's angels, by the way, are beyond counting. وَمَا يَعْلَمُ جُنُودَ رَبِّكَ إِلَّا هُوَ. You cannot count the number of angels. There are more than angels that you can imagine. أَطَّتِ السَّمَاءُ وَحُقَّ لَهَا أَن تَأِطَّ. The heavens are creaking, and they have every right to creak, because there is not a single space, even a hand span, except that there is an angel standing, doing ruku', prostrating, praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The heavens above, we think they are empty. They are creaking with angels. So every one of us has an angel. ثُمَّ تَوَفَّاكُمْ مَلَكُ الْمَوْتِ الَّذِي وُكِّلَ بِكُمْ. Allah says in the Quran, then the Malakul Maut that has been assigned to you will come and take your soul. That Malakul Maut has been told, at this time, at this day, at this location, you will go and you will take that person's soul. And that Malakul Maut will come without any problems. You cannot protect yourself. He's not in your schedule calendar. You don't schedule that appointment. That appointment will be put upon you. You don't schedule that appointment. And when that appointment comes, all other appointments will be permanently cancelled. That is the reality. And Allah Azza wa Jal mentions in the Quran and the Sunnah as well mentioned, that when the person sees the angel comes in two forms. So the death begins the hisab. The beginnings of death are the beginnings of hisab. Meaning, heaven and hell, of course, they are decided officially in judgment day, of course. But from the time of death, you start getting an indication where you are headed. From the angel of death, you start getting an indication. Because the angel of death will either be coming in a merciful form or in a harsh form. So you get the beginnings already. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when the time for death comes for the believer, the angel of death comes and he takes his soul. Look at the example he gave. Like water is poured from a glass. Smooth, clear. He takes his soul that easily. There's no harshness, there's no jerking, there's no problem. And the most beautiful shrouds are put on him, and the most scented perfumes. And as far as he can see, the angels are surrounding him with good news, glad tidings, happy faces. And the angels say to him, don't be scared, don't worry, we're going to take care of you. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَا اللَّهُ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا تَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ أَلَّا تَخَافُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا وَأَبْشِرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ الَّذِي كُنْتُمْ تُوعَدُونَ نَحْنُ أَوْلِيَاؤُكُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ. Again, this is in the Quran. Those who say Allah is our Lord and they remain firm on that belief, the angels will come down in armies and armies. تَتَنَزَّلُ, as the Prophet said, as far as the eyes can see. Why? Because every person is going to be terrified, without exception. We are all scared of death. And when the time of death comes, we will be scared, we will be worried. So imagine the first thing that you see as your eyes open in the next world, you will see beautiful, handsome creations of Allah. Creations of Allah whose very presence brings you mercy, whose very appearance brings you calmness. These are as far as the eye can see. You are scared. And they will say, don't worry. لَا تَخَافُوا. You're worried. I'm leaving my family, my children. وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا. We're going to take care of them. We are your protectors. نَحْنُ أَوْلِيَاؤُكُمْ. In this world we took care of you. We'll take care of you now as well. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, the angels will carry him gently, one after the other, gently pushing him up and up and up until he goes up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course he will not see Allah at this time, but Allah Azza wa Jalla will say, write the name of this servant in the register of good books. Uktubu kitab abdi fil illiyin. Because there's illiyin and sijjin. Write the name of the servant in illiyin. And then he will be gently taken down, gently handled until he reaches his qabr. And there the qabr will become a vast place for him. He will smell the fragrance of Jannah. He will see his palace in Jannah. The grave will become light and he will make dua to Allah. Oh Allah, hasten judgment day so that I can enter Jannah. Oh Allah, hasten qiyamah so that I can enter my palace in Jannah. This is the one who will be a good person. And the opposite, our Rasulullah said, when the fajr, the fasiq, when the kafir, when his time comes, the angels of punishment will come. The very look of them will strike terror into our hearts. Looking at them, and we will be terrified. And they will extract the soul. The Prophet said, listen to this example. It's a terrifying example. Like wet wool is dragged through an iron comb. Imagine, wet wool dragged through an iron comb. The soul is going to be literally dragged out, tortured to leave. Because it doesn't want the akhirah, it wants to stay. It's terrified, wants to go back. And then the person will see, as far as the eye can see, the angels of punishment, whose very looks will terrify. And they will mention him with the worst of names, and remind him of the worst of deeds, and handle him with the worst of care. And then Allah will say, put the name of this person in Sijjin, in the other register. Not the register of the good deeds, the register of the bad people. And he will then be returned to his grave, where the punishments of the grave will begin. And he will see his place in Jahannam. And he will say, oh Allah, never cause the judgment to come. Oh Allah, never cause the judgment to come. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ said, the qabr, the grave, is the first station of all of the stations of the hereafter. And that will begin the period of the barzakh. What is the barzakh? The barzakh literally means the interim. It literally in Arabic means the middle. It's the barrier. Allah says in the Quran, وَبَيْنَهُمَا بَرْزَخٌ لَا يَبْغِيَانِ. Between the two oceans, there is a barrier that the oceans will not cross. And so the barzakh is called barzakh because it is the barrier between this world and the next world. Between our death and between The Qiyamah. And the Qiyamah begins with the trumpet. How long is the Barzakh? The Barzakh is beyond time. And so, the one who dies close to Judgment Day versus the son of Adam who died 50,000 years ago, for them the Barzakh is the same. It's not our time. Time is a different reality in the Barzakh. It has nothing to do with our life over here. It is a separate reality. And there is life in the Barzakh. And the more righteous a person, the more they will enjoy the Barzakh and be at comfort in the Barzakh. So much so, the most righteous of all peoples, these are the prophets, they will be praying in the Barzakh as they would pray in this world. The Prophet ﷺ said, I passed by the qabr of Musa and I saw him standing and praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, life is so peaceful for them, they're standing and praying in the qabr. Because that's their life. And the shaheed, his barzakh as well is the barzakh of peace and comfort. As the Prophet ﷺ said, his ruh will be in Jannah flying around. Literally, he won't even be in this dunya. And the righteous, they will enjoy the barzakh. Because the barzakh will become the beginnings of Jannah. As we said, he will smell the fragrance of Jannah. He will see the palace of Jannah. So he's at peace. He knows he's going to go there. If anything, hasty. He wants it to come. And the opposite is also true. That the Prophet ﷺ said that the qabr is the most terrifying thing I have ever seen. Nothing is more terrifying than the qabr. And he mentioned that the qabr has azab. And the qabr has the fitna. There's something called the fitna of the qabr and the adab of the qabr and the na'im of the qabr. Three things are there. What are these things? The fitna of the qabr, the fitna is the examination of the qabr, the test of the qabr. This is called the fitna. And the fitna is basically munkar and nakir coming and asking you the three questions. Who is your Lord? Who is your Prophet? And what is your religion? And at that stage, there is no cheating on the exam. You cannot just memorize the answers and have them on a piece of paper. At that stage, your life and your lifestyle will answer for you, not your tongue. At that stage, did you really worship Allah? That is the question. Did you follow the Prophet ﷺ as a role model? That is the question. Did you live your life in accordance with Islam? That is the question. Your tongue means nothing. Your life will answer. مَنْ رَبُّكْ مَنْ نَبِيُّكْ مَا دِينُكْ. And at that stage, if your actions did not live up to your words, you will not be able to cheat on the exam. This is called the fitna of the qabr. And then after this, if you pass, you get the na'im ul-qabr, the blessings of the qabr, we talked about them. And if you don't, you get the azab ul-qabr, which is the punishment of the qabr. And the punishment of the qabr is the beginnings of the punishment of the hereafter. And it is something that we seek refuge from Allah from. And Aisha says, I never saw the Prophet ﷺ pray salah of the five salah, except that after it he would say, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min fitnat al-qabr wa min adhab al-qabr. It's a common dua. Every time he would pray, he would say, oh Allah, I seek refuge in you from the fitna of the qabr and from the adhab of the qabr. And so the fitna is one thing, the adhab is another thing. And we seek refuge in Allah from the both of them. And we want the qabr to be a place of na'im, a place of blessing, not a place of torture. And of course, this is the barzakh here. Final point here, time is getting out, one of the time for Q&A as well. Is there contact between us and the people of the barzakh? Is there contact between the people of this dunya and the people of the barzakh? Our scholars have very widely agreed, almost unanimous, that there is contact between the people of this world and between the people of barzakh. But, important point, this contact is something Allah gives to people that He chooses. There is no way that you can contact somebody in the barzakh through anything that you do. It is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or a test and a trial. Could be a gift, it could be, yani it could be both. And generally speaking, this contact, it occurs during sleep. Why? Because when you are asleep, you are in the same paradigm, the same dimension, call it, as the barzakh. When you go to sleep, you are essentially kind of sort of wandering into the barzakh, but you're still connected to your body. So when you're in your sleep, it is very common to see deceased people. And our scholars mention it is very likely, now here's an important disclaimer, if you see somebody who is deceased in the dream, it could be one of three things, okay? One of three things. Number one, it is possible, rare but possible, that it is shaitan taking the form of your loved one. How will you know this? If your loved one says something haram, to do something haram, for sure this is shaitan. Shaitan will use the form of your loved one. And you get some advice, oh, don't worry about stealing the money, go ahead, steal the money. If you, there's money you want to steal, you're wondering, your conscience is getting to you, you go to sleep, you see a loved one, oh, don't worry, go ahead. This is not Allah and His Messenger, this is not your loved one telling you to do something haram. This is shaitan using the tactic of your loved one. Definitely throw out the window. Not possible that an actual deceased person will come and tell you to do something haram, because they know what you should be doing in the next life, okay? The second, it could be from your own imagination. You really miss your grandmother. You've been thinking about your grandmother all day long. Then you go to sleep and you just have a brief vision of your grandmother. Your sleep is projecting your imagination. And so you think you see this. How do you know it's your sleep? Generally speaking, the sign that it is your imagination is that you don't remember what happens. It's just a vague memory, and then maybe even when you wake up, you have a vague idea, then within the day you forget that, oh, you don't even remember that you saw the dream. You know, when you wake up, generally, you have an idea that there was a dream. Within 5 minutes, you have one inkling. Within 10 minutes, you've forgotten the whole dream. So those types of dreams, they are from our own imagination. The third type of dream, which is a gift from Allah, as our Prophet ﷺ said, the true dream is 1/46th part of prophethood. Being a prophet, you have 46 things, check, 46 requirements. One requirement is your dreams are true. And our Prophet ﷺ said, لَمْ يَبْقَ مِنُ النُّبُوَّةِ إِلَّا الْمُبَشِّرَاتِ. Nothing is left from prophethood except true dreams. So, if you see a dream where you have a good conversation with your loved one, you remember it, or at least snippets of it, and it's overall, you know, positive, whatnot, then insha'Allah ta'ala, insha'Allah, this is a gift from Allah that He gave you for meeting your loved one. And of course, of the greatest, in fact, the greatest, is for us to see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a dream. And if we see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a dream, it must be him. There is no other possibility. Because he said, when one of you sees me in a dream, then know that you have seen me, because shaitan cannot take my form. Which means he can take other people's forms. That's why I said you have to be careful of the three. But if anybody sees the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a dream, that this is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, shaitan cannot take the shape of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's a beautiful, beautiful good tidings for those that have seen the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a dream and have interacted with him, that they have truly seen the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, question here, bit of a freaky question, huh? Can we see the people of the barzakh when we are awake? Or if I were to quote a famous movie, can we see dead people? Can we see dead people while we're awake? You should not? Well, I mean, you can, or you, what does it mean you should not? Why should not? Huh? It means if you do, there's a mental problem. Yeah, I agree with you, yes, okay. We hope that you do not, yes. If you do, then you need to go see a psychiatrist, yes, basically. From a religious perspective, you cannot see the arwah of the dead when you are awake. Is that clear? From a religious perspective, you cannot see the souls of the deceased when you are awake. If you see the souls of the deceased, one of two things, either you yourself are a little bit loose up there, right? Or, what else is the other possibility? Shaitan, very good, shaitan. We do not believe in ghosts the way that this culture does. We do not believe that the spirits of the dead walk around, no. The spirits of the dead are in the barzakh, they've gone. They have nothing to do with this world. They are completely disconnected. We might enter their world when we're asleep, but they cannot enter our world ever. The door is shut. So The only time is we said in the dream, and that is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now of course the talk is only part one. Inshallah I'll come back and give part two. Part two is what happens at the trumpet. Okay? So inshallah next time I come, this will be my topic inshallah. That this basically goes from the time of death up until the barzakh. Then the next part of the story begins, and that is the trumpet and qiyamah, and what will happen in qiyamah, and the hisab, and the ard, and the shafa'a, and the qantara, and the mizan, and all of those various things that are going to take place, the hawd, and all of these are there. That's another different topic. And in the end, we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses us with a good life so that we have a peaceful death. The purpose of thinking of death is not to go into depression, not to become sad. No! The purpose of always thinking of death is to make the best of life and to live life to the maximum, meaning prepare for the akhirah, do the best of deeds, leave the greatest of legacies, make sure that when we go, our family, our friends, our loved ones, they have nothing but the best thoughts of us, that when we leave, the malakul maut that comes is the malak of rahmah, that when we go, the angels mention the good things that we did, that when we enter the qabr, our good deeds will make the qabr vast for us and enlightened for us, that on judgment day, our hisab will be heavy. That is why we think of death. And we ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with a beautiful death. We ask Allah gives us the last phrase in our life to be La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. We ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us a death of ease and comfort, and that He saves us from the sakaratul maut. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to die in Medina and to be buried in Baqi' al-Gharqad, the most blessed of all graveyards. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He makes our graves a vast place of light, that He makes our graves a place of rahmah and a place of na'im, that He makes our graves a place where we can see our abode in Jannah and smell the fragrances of Jannah, and we seek refuge in Allah, that our graves become a place of punishment. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be resurrected under His shade when there is no shade other than the shade of Allah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be invited by our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam directly by our names to drink from the fountain, the hawd, the day that there is no water other than the water of the hawd. We ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to drink from the hawd, the drink. Once we drink it, we will never be thirsty for all of eternity. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make our scales heavy on judgment day. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be given our books in the right hand, and that we are then boasting to everybody, Ha'umukhra'u kitabiyah, come look at my book, I have come prepared to meet this book. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He grant us the shafa'ah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on judgment day. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He makes our feet firm as we cross over the sirat. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He gives us light when there is no light other than the light that He bestows upon the believers. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be of the first batches that enter Jannah, and to be of those who see Him on judgment day and in Jannah itself. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be in the company of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannatul Firdaus al-A'la, under the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For only Allah is capable of doing this, and He is the Rahman and the Rahim and the Arhamur Rahimeen. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barak ala abdi Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.